Thank you. Thank you. It's dispiriting, to me at least, to note how many of the most popular podcasts these days, especially the American ones, it must be observed, keep picking at the scabs of what are called the culture wars, you know? And feasting on all the blood and pus that oozes from that terrible wound. Opened up in public discourses, in the politics, and all other aspects of life, in the West especially. A seismic crack that grows wider every day. And as it widens, the armies on each side shriek more and more incontinently at their perceived enemies on the other side, across the divide. Their gestures and insults grow ever huger, cruder, and louder. Of course, as the chasm widens, the distance between the two sides increases, and the chance of either group hearing or interpreting the other, even if they wanted to, which they don't, decreases daily. Hatred, contempt, distrust, fear, and abhorrence each feels for the other is absolute, immovable, implacable. Like me, do not have a place on either side. You can find us cowering down in the ravine below while the armies clash, clatter, and screech above. And what are these two mighty clashing forces? On the one side are ranged the newly energized battalions of the populist right, or alt-right, or nativist right, for whom what they call political correctness, globalism, internationalism, and the ideals of social justice are dragons to be slain by their fearless, taboo-busting white knights of the cross. They claim to stand for ordinary people, tired of the failures, the moral relativism, and all the virtue-signaling pieties of progressive politics, and to champion values that often magically combine Christianity or even Buddhism with anti-state libertarianism. Against them, across this ever-widening fissure, are massed the armies of a new ideological left. A generation of illiberal liberals, intolerantly fixated on identity politics, semi-schooled in impenetrable academic jargon, and prone to gabbling about things like cultural appropriation and the heteronormative patriarchy, in comically sanctimonious and barely literal battle. Champions and orators on both sides take far more time and derive far more pleasure in riding out to mock the opposition's mouthpieces and spear their sacred cows than they do in making any real effort to explain a credible alternative agenda or present anything like a thoughtful manifesto, credo, philosophy. It's not about what anyone stands for so much as what they stand against. Not what enlivens them so much as what enrages them. Not what inspires their loyalty and trust, but what inflames their hatred and enmity. We're all like that. So sobmouthingly, arse-paralysingly easy. Which of us can't savage the dumbest loon from the other side, nail their fallacies, and expose their hypocrisies? It's the contemporary version of the Circus Maximus. You know, instead of gladiatorial combat, we have shaming and railing, denouncing and disgracing, and the mob screaming for Caesar's imperial thumbs down, which today means Emperor Zuckerberg cutting off their Facebook page or Pontifex Dorsey deleting their Twitter ID, and similar contemporary modes of public execution and
punishment. 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 Punishment.
engage with the coherent, decent people across the divide, for the modern world throws up easier targets. We look with gloating relish to the wilder shores of anti-vaxxers, flat earthers, white supremacists, denialists, fundamentalists, history rewriters, deplatformers, deranged gender and race identitarians, and statue smashers obsessed by cultural appropriation and misplaced cisgender pronouning. We look to such outlying fanatics to justify our contempt for the entirety of the foe. How much easier to do that and look at and listen to the more reasonable, sane, and cogent viewpoints. Nuance and complexity are so bloody hard. And worse than hard, time-consuming and boring. We have machines and devices to wash our clothes and dirty dishes, to calculate and convert measurements, to print and transmit our words. The modern world also gives us automated ways of coming to conclusions without the bother and toil of thinking, reading, researching, reflecting, scrutinizing, and wondering for ourselves. Heaven knows I'm guilty too. Shortcuts and simplifications are as appealing to me as they are to anyone. So you know what? Fuck all this posturing and snarling. Fuck all this fake outrage and real outrage. Fuck all this redacting people from history. Fuck all this year zero zealotry. Fuck the boorish pelting of balls of shit at those in the pillory. Fuck all this second guessing of other people's motives. Fuck all this meanness, malice and mendacity. It's time we understood whose fault it really is. And I am in a happy position to be able to let you know. Absolutely. I have looked at this problem long and hard from every angle. I can now state with confident certainty that the fault lies entirely.
New electronic media or our new gadgets. You push a button, the world's yours. You want to talk about the world getting smaller? Well, it's thanks to these things. Everywhere is now our own media. You know, it's like Ferrari and Kenya.
Good afternoon. What are you doing
with that?
Not only is the world becoming more available, our mind and our energy.
Let me put it this way, the 9000 series is the most reliable computer ever built. No 9000 computer has ever made a mistake in the story of
The white pieces, and he literally stunned us. Yes, sir, with.
Says to me that he's trying to get the computer out of its book and bamboozle the computer.
Thank you.
The computer should be very happy. It started the game with a disadvantage. It played poorly some moves, a number of moves, in fact. Now it's in an endgame of pawn up. I'd be very happy.
Very happy.
The computer should be very happy. The computer should be very happy. The computer should be very happy. The computer should be very happy. The computer should be very happy. Thank you.
Yeah.